Continuing our series on emotions. Tonight we're thinking about emotion which is, unlike lots of emotions, is strongly associated with a colour. We're thinking about an emotion which has physiological effects which are often visible. When you're feeling this emotion, your heart starts racing, the blood starts coursing through your veins. You feel the kind of the power of adrenaline being released. Your face might get flushed. We're thinking that an emotion which is very powerful, which gives many people reasons to live, reasons to kill, and reasons to die. This emotion, almost like no other, makes us do foolish things that we often regret. As many of you know, tonight we're thinking about anger. Now, just as I start, I'd love to know, anonymously or publicly, if whatever you're happy with, I'd love to know what gets your blood boiling. Do write in the chat. If you want to do it anonymously, send it to Sophie and she'll repost it to the rest of us anonymously. If you're just happy to say, do say. What is it that really gets your temperature kind of sky high? I'll tell you what it is for me. As a cyclist who used to cycle around, particularly in Birmingham, it's cars cutting me up. I don't know why, but I turn into the Hulk. It makes me very annoyed. I wonder what it is that does it for you. Just tell me in the chat as I continue to speak. One of the hard things about anger that I've thought as I've reflected on this theme is that it's almost intrinsically moral in its nature. Anger is basically our morality in action, kind of our morality animated. So if you add up our beliefs plus our personality and a bit of adrenaline and a situation, that's when we get angry. And when we get angry, you'll know this and I've experienced this too, it almost always feels so right. It's our morality in action. And so someone cuts you up as you're cycling along, or even as you're driving along, a kind of car kind of swerves in and then brakes, or you get overcharged by your bank, or you get ignored by your boss, or you get hurt by a friend or let down by a family member, you get insulted. And you can feel it kind of surging up inside you. And the question is, when that happens, how ought we feel? How ought we feel? And sometimes it's not even that simple to answer. Often we do feel angry in those situations. And when we do, it's very easy to dismiss, isn't it? It's just my personality. I'm just a bit fiery. I'm under pressure at the moment. Well, actually, he's so annoying and so insensitive. When we get angry, it's easy to excuse. I can't help it. Well, I said sorry afterwards. Well, that's just a trigger for me. Easy to excuse. It's easy to justify. Well, they were wrong. That was dangerous. I care about that. You know that would hurt me. It's easy to justify. But the thing about anger is that it's so hard to control, isn't it? When someone does press your buttons, if that is the trigger issue, if they did put you at danger, if they did almost deliberately ignore you, so hard to control. And yet we must control it, because as we can see later, anger is dangerous. And wonderfully we can, particularly if we're a Christian. And so we're going to have our reading now. Megan's going to read it for us. We're in Ephesians chapter 4. Starting at verse 17, and then we're going to dive into it. I'm going to just give people a moment to find it. Ephesians chapter 4, starting at verse 17.
Okay.
Megan's going to help us with that.
Ephesians 4, verse 17. So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as the Gentiles do, in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality so as to indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed. That, however, is not the way of life you learned when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, and to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully to your neighbor, for we are all members of one body. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those in need. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness, rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you.
Perfect. Thanks so much, Ben. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you that you not only tell us how to live, but give us the power to live in ways that are pleasing to you and good for those around us. I pray tonight that you would shape us, change us, cause us to live in a way that pleases you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our text for tonight is verse 26 of Ephesians chapter 4. Let me just read it again. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. Now, the NIV translates this, in your anger, do not sin. But almost every other translation translates it, as we've seen underneath there, be angry and do not sin. And that's because that's more literally what it is. It's a command. Be angry, don't sin. And so the Bible commands all sorts of things from us. It commands us to love, it commands us to rejoice, it commands us to weep with those who weep, and it also commands us to be angry, which is interesting. And it does that because anger can be good. It can be good. And there's three reasons why I say anger can be good. And the first is this, because as we look in the Bible, we see that God is angry. God is angry. Someone went through the Bible and counted how many times that the Bible speaks about someone being angry. The answer is that there's 222 times that someone is angry in the Bible. And the question is, how many of those times do you think, percentage-wise, God is the person who's angry? How many times do you think? Maybe 50% of the time? Maybe 70%? 80% of the references to anyone being angry in the Bible are attributed to God. It's God who's angry. Now, we're not just playing theology by numbers. Clearly, anger is part of who God is as he relates to human beings. But actually, in one of the most kind of quoted verses in the Bible, God says this about himself. If God had a Twitter handle, Yahweh the Triune, this would be his kind of bio, his little short kind of clip about who he is. And this is what God says: the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation. We're told that this is who God is. This is his kind of self-definition. He's compassionate and gracious, yes. He's slow to anger, so he doesn't fly off the handle. He's not always angry. He's slow to anger. And yet anger is part of his kind of self-revelation of who he is. He doesn't let the guilty go unpunished. Now, for some people, that's horrific. Some people want to just say kind of God is love, and anger isn't really a kind of part of God or how he expresses himself in relationship to human beings. Maybe some people think of people that they've known, maybe horrible kind of teachers or aggressive parents. And they think kind of a God like that is just kind of abhorrent. Maybe think that that means God's irrational and impulsive and unpredictable, like many of us can be. But we have to remember, this is the Lord, this is Yahweh. This is not our headmaster. You see, human love is based on limited information. But God's love is based on him being all-knowing and never learning. God has all the facts at his disposal. Human love, human anger is very embodied. And we're affected by hormones and tiredness and alcohol and adrenaline. God has no body. So it's not kind of, he's not subject to the forces of his body influencing him. He has no body. Our anger is affected by time. In one moment, we can be red hot angry. And yet 30 years later, we look back and say, actually, I overreacted. God is both inside time and outside time. He looks at eternity with objectivity. Extraordinary to get your head around. Our anger is distorted by sin. We're biased. We have wrong sympathies. God's anger is pure and blazing and objective and good and intense. And so it's so different from our anger. The relationship between our anger and God's is like the relationship between a kitten and a lion. Yes, they're the same species, but my goodness, they're different animals. And so God is angry. And it's a good thing. It's a great thing that God doesn't tolerate all that is wrong and all that destroys this world. But that's God. Is it right for us to be angry? Is it right for us to be angry? Which brings us to our second point. Jesus was angry. One of the funny things about anger is that often anger is the defense of things that we think matter most. Anger is us defending the things that really matter to us. I wonder if you were going to give me the top four things that make you angry. I guess it'd take a while to kind of reflect. But I wonder what those things would be. I'll argue those things also tell us the things that are most important to you. Well, when Jesus was on earth, he got angry. And it's fascinating to see what animated him. Four things. Firstly, hard-heartedness. There's this incident on the Sabbath where Jesus is going to heal a man who had a withered hand. And he's about to do it. And he asks the religious leaders around him, is this the right thing to do on the Sabbath, even though you think it breaks your interpretation of the law? They're silent because they know it's a good thing to do in some ways, but they know it goes against their traditions. And Jesus looked around at them in anger and deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts. They refused to submit to what Jesus was doing, his agenda, his interpretation of the law, even though they'd seen what he'd done and heard their teaching. And so he was angry at their hard-heartedness. He got angry at disobedience. There's this incident where Jesus has healed a man with leprosy. And we're told that Jesus sent him away with a strong warning. The word strong warning is more of an angry rebuke. It's the kind of thing I would say to kind of Jasper, don't hit your brother like that. It's an angry, strong rebuke. He rebukes him because he knows that this guy is going to ignore what he said, which is not to tell anyone about the healing. And so he rebukes him strongly. He gets angry at disobedience. He gets angry at exclusivity. Jesus came for all, even the most pathetic, weak, marginalized people in society. And so there's Jesus talking with people, and children are coming to him, and the disciples are trying to push them away. The master doesn't want to the master doesn't want to engage with children. They're beneath him. They're too lowly. And Jesus, when he saw this, he was indignant. He was raging. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me." Jesus came to all. He's angry with exclusiveness. And finally, there's this graveside scene. Jesus comes and one of his best friends, Lazarus, has died. His sisters are weeping And when Jesus sees one of his sisters weeping and the Jews who'd come along with her weeping, he was deeply moved. That word deeply moved is an angry word. It's an indignant word. Deeply moved in spirit and troubled. We thought about this last week. He then weeps in response to this. Why is he angry? Why is he sad? Just because of the brokenness of this world, the suffering of people in this world. It's not right, and it infuriates Jesus. What really animates Jesus? Well, first and foremost, it's people. It's people who are hurting, people who are suffering. And we see that he cares about all people. He wants all people to be able to come to him. He's animated by the brokenness of this world. And one of the chief things that is wrong with this world is that people that are hard-hearted towards their maker and their savior, and it enrages him. It's interesting. The things that matter most to Jesus are the things that matter most. Or we put it the other way around. Things that matter most to Jesus are the things that matter most. These are the things that Jesus cares about. I wonder what our top four would be compared to Jesus. Again, it's easy to say, well, that was Jesus. He was perfect. Is there anyone else who's angry in the Bible rightly? And there's lots of people. So we see Moses. Moses, as he walks out of Pharaoh's palace, Pharaoh's experienced 9 plagues and the 10th one is coming. And Moses says this, or this is what happens. All these officials of yours will come to me, bowing down before me and saying, go, you and your people who follow you. After that, I will leave. This is Moses saying, this is what's going to happen after this 10th plague. Then as Moses walks out, his face is red. I can't believe this is what it takes for Pharaoh to let Israel go. Again, hard-heartedness. If you read through the Psalms, you see that David is often angry. As people rebel against God, it infuriates him. I've got a couple of Psalms there for you to look up in your own time. Or Nehemiah, as the people come back to the land and they're charging each other interest, abusing each other, even though the law tells them not to, even though they were chucked out of Israel for not obeying the law. And so when people are kind of crying out to the Lord in light of what's going on, Nehemiah is raging. But the point I'm trying to make is this. The Bible says that we ought to be angry. That righteous anger is possible, even for sinful human beings like you and I. But I think it's more than that. It's saying sometimes it's not just possible, but it's okay for us to be angry. More than that, actually, sometimes it'll be wrong for us not to be angry. C.S. Lewis, the guy who wrote the Chronicles of Narnia, tells this story of being on a train, and he was opposite some soldiers who were engaged in the Second World War, and they were commenting that they thought the government might have made up some of the claims about what the Nazis were up to just to justify the war. And the thing that troubled Lewis as he heard this conversation is that the soldiers didn't seem to think that was much of an issue. They just kind of said that's what was going on. They didn't seem to think that was malicious or evil. And so he says this, if they, these soldiers, had perceived and felt as a man, should feel, the diabolical wickedness which they believed our rulers to be committing, and then forgiven them, they would have been saints. But not to perceive it at all, not to even be tempted to resentment, to accept it as the most ordinary thing in the world, argues a terrifying insensibility. Clearly, these young men had, on that subject anyway, no conception of good and evil whatsoever. Thus, the absence of anger, especially that sort of anger which we call indignation, can, in my opinion, be the most alarming symptom. there are things going on in this world which should anger us. And there are times when an absence of anger is actually alarming indeed. Be angry, Ephesians 4 says. But here's the thing. It's easy to say, but it's so hard to be angry and to be angry rightly. Aristotle puts it like this. Anyone can be angry, that's easy. But to be angry with the right person to the right degree, at the right time, for the right purpose, and in the right way, that is not within everybody's power. And it's not easy. Actually, I think it is in some of our power by the help of the Holy Spirit, but it's jolly hard. I suspect we all identify with Aristotle's kind of thought there. It's very hard to do anger right, which is why most of what the Bible says about anger is negative. Harnessing anger, I think, is like harnessing the sea with a surfboard. Who's ever tried surfing? A few of you. It's such fun, isn't it? When you can harness the sea, but so often the sea's harnessing me and chucking me to the bottom of the sea. I can't control it. It's a wonderful thing to do, but I just can't control it. And it's so easy to think you're in control and then realize that you've messed up kind of big start. And even though anger can sometimes feel good in the moment, afterwards it often leaves a kind of sour taste in our mouth because we know it's wrong. And we know at least our motives are mixed, if not they're malicious. And the reason why anger is wrong is spelled out for us in the Bible. We're going to explore it before we think about how we can challenge it. A couple of reasons why anger is wrong. Firstly, it consumes our hearts. Do you remember what the first sin outside the Garden of Eden was? Cain had brought his vegetable sacrifice to God. God wasn't happy with it. Probably about how he bought it rather than what he brought. And so Cain is raging. And then the Lord said this to Cain, why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? If you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must rule over it. Sin is like anger is like a power. It's dangerous. It's like a panther that's come near and it's crouching and it's going to have you. It's going to eat you alive. And so God says, be warned, it's going to take over. The thing is that anger doesn't hunt alone. Anger hunts in packs. It hunts with its siblings of jealousy and envy and bitterness and resentment and hatred and malice. And it's deadly. And so God's warning to Cain and warning to us is that when something happens, we have a moment. When that email comes, when that comment is made, when that button is pushed, we have a moment where we have a choice. Are we going to be ruled by anger or are we going to rule our anger? We have that choice. And it's so easy to be ruled by anger. And when we are ruled by anger, it affects our speech. Listen to Jesus on this. You have heard it said to the people long ago, you shall not murder, and anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who's angry with a brother or sister will be subject to judgment. Again, anyone who says to a brother or sister, raka, is answerable to the court. And anyone who says, you fool, will be in danger of the fire of hell. Note what Jesus says. He says that murder is of the same species as angry feelings and angry words. Obviously it's not the same, but it's the same class of feeling and action. Secondly, notice how serious he says it is. He says, if you murder, you'll be subject to judgment. But if you're angry with your brother, you'll be subject to judgment. And if you say raka, which is an insult, or you fool, which is where we get the word moron from, you'll be in danger of the fire of hell. Sobering thoughts, there'll be some people in eternal judgment whose primary expression of the rebellion against God is their anger. He says this is deadly serious. And I presume the reason why insulting people and being angry is as serious as murder is because the same thing, the same root is behind it. The reason why murder is wrong, we're told in Genesis 9, is because people, whoever they are, whatever they've done, are made in the image of God. And so to insult them, to demean them, is wrong. And yet, because of our anger, we do. And our anger in our hearts overflows into the mouth. Out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so we swear in our minds or outwardly at people. And so we're sarcastic. And so we're argumentative. We're verbally abusive. We're short. We're aggressive. We're passive aggressive. We're active aggressive. We give people almost the worst thing we can do, the silent treatment. Anger poisons our speech. And because it poisons our speech, it kills our relationships. Again, C.S. Lewis in the Screwtape Letters, where he kind of imagines a senior devil talking to a younger devil. Lewis puts these words in the mouth of a senior devil. It says this: our task, as always, is to undermine and to divide. What's it that the devil wants to do amongst humanity in general and the church? He wants to undermine our confidence in the gospel and to divide. And that's what happens. We saw this in Ephesians chapter 4. In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you're still angry. And do not give who the devil a foothold. The devil loves seething, bitter anger. And so later on in the chapter, he says this: get rid of all bitterness and rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Instead, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ, in Christ, God forgave you. In Ephesians, we see that God's desire for the world and for the church is to be united under the lordship of his son, King Jesus. But the devil's desire is for us to be divided, to us to be in factions, to us to be warring and hating each other. So anger causes fights and backstabbing, which is what slander is. It causes bad will. And it leaves a bitter taste in our mouths. It leads people to avoid you or avoid certain topics with you. And of course they would. Look what Proverbs says about anger. An angry person stirs up conflict, and a hot-tempered person commits many sins. Who wants to hang out with someone like this? And so anger divides. Anger leads us giving people a wide berth. This is particularly true in marriages. Anger kills our relationships. It's been heartbreaking over the years to see that even in Christian marriages, anger can lead to verbal abuse and psychological abuse and even physical abuse. And I hope this isn't the case, but if there's any hint, even a hint of this in our marriages in Christchurch, I'm going to say this, obviously it has to stop. This is abhorrent. It has to stop. You need to get help, and you need to get help now. Anger is an acid that eats away at marriages and churches and friendships and connect groups and societies. And it leaves a sour taste in our mouth, and we know it's bad and it's ugly. Have you had that moment when you've just heard yourself? You've heard what you said to a friend or a spouse or a colleague. You hear yourself and you think, oh, that's so embarrassing. Why did I say that? Why did I just react like that? It's ugly, isn't it? Anger's awful. It kills our relationships. And it's serious. If you look through the qualifications for eldership, if you've got a problem, if you've got a serious problem with anger, you can't be in church leadership. We're to be known for our gentleness and our self-control. Actually, it's more serious than that. Jesus says, actually, if you've got a serious problem with anger, and there's nothing that you're doing to restrain that, actually, you're in danger of being excluded from the kingdom of God itself. Anger is a massive problem for God. He hates false anger. And so for some of you, this is a massive issue. And if it is a massive issue for you, please do talk to someone. Allow someone to help you work through this. Come talk to me, whoever you need to speak to, your Connect group leader, whoever. And for many of us, this is just an area of oversight. But for whoever you are, I've got just three short things to say before we go to questions. One's a practical tip, and then the other two are spiritual beta blockers, spiritual truths that we can digest to just lower our heartbeat when anger comes. So first, a practical tip, sort it out as soon as possible. This is Jesus just after the bit where he talks about saying rakah and saying you fool. He says, therefore, if you're offering your gift at the altar and there you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled to them, then come and offer your gift. Basically, you wouldn't walk out of a house if you noticed that a little fire had started, would you? You're just going to put it out instantly. And similarly, you shouldn't walk into church realizing that the fire of anger is raging in your heart. Instead, you should put it out quickly. Put it out quickly. It could be awkward, it can be inconvenient, but it needs to be reconciled. Maybe the Spirit's just saying to you tonight, there's the fire of anger in your heart tonight. You need to put it out quickly. Put it out quickly. But two spiritual beta blockers, two spiritual truths that can just lower the temperature when you get angry in a way that you know isn't good. And the first is this: remember that justice will come. Let me just read. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it's written, it's mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. You remember the instances in Minneapolis where George Floyd was killed. Do you remember why people were so angry? They thought that Chauvin was going to be, he wasn't going to be prosecuted for what happened to George. Whatever you think of what's going to happen, they thought that he was going to get away with it. He was going to literally get away with what they thought was murder. And anger often has that sense of someone saying, actually, something needs to change. Something needs to happen here. It's not right. And you need to pay. That's what anger often expresses in our hearts. But one of the great things about being a Christian, one of the wonderful things about knowing the Lord Jesus is King and alive, is knowing that justice will be done, either in hell for eternity or on the cross as Jesus dies for our sins. On the final day, we will look around at this universe and say it to the just universe. You see, the Bible promises us that no stone will not be overturned, or every stone will be overturned. That's an easy way of putting it. Every closet will be opened. Every thought and fact and feeling will be judged by the perfect eternal judge. Justice is coming, friends. And so we don't need to be so angry. And the second one is remember who you are. As I've read through the Bible on this topic of anger, I've seen that the biggest reason why people get angry is because their ego has been insulted. It's one of those, do you know who I am moment? How dare you treat me like this moments? Someone's kind of ignored you or said something to you that undermines your position or insulted you. And obviously it's not a right thing to do, but it riles you because your ego has been bruised. Well, in the gospel, we're told two wonderful truths that, again, just lower the temperature. Okay, it's not right, but again, just lowers the temperature. Timothy Keller puts it like this. The gospel is this. We are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus than we ever dared hope. The more that we believe just how awful we are and actually how little we deserve because of our sin, and yet how cherished we are and accepted and loved, and what status we have in Christ, the less fragile our egos will be. It's easy to say. I've been working on this for years. It's so hard to walk, but it's true. We are sinful more than we know and more loved than we know. So the Bible says, yes, be angry, but don't sin. You need to leave it there. Good. We've got a few moments of questions. I won't go too much over 7 o'clock. Let me just have a quick whip through these. If there's always injustice, should we always be righteously angry? Yes and no. I think this is a bit like sorrow. There's always going to be things in the world which are broken. But I think what we see from Jesus and what is our human experience is that there'll be times when issues are brought in front of us, either because we've kind of literally just stepped over them, or the news, or our kind of circle of friends, and it'll be those things will make us particularly angry. We should be kind of unhappy with the state of the world in terms of injustice. But I think it will be an unusual person who's always feeling angry, even if they're kind of unhappy. I think that reflects Jesus' experience, I think, as well. Do you have any thoughts on the connection between bitterness and anger? Only that, and this is just my understanding of what bitterness is. Bitterness is like a long-term, low-level anger, I think. Which is why it's just not great. It kind of, so that idea of anger being acidic, or like a kind of corrosive acid, kind of to hold on to anger long term just eats away at you. It's not great at all. Do not take revenge, for God will do it. What should we do to those who do evil? I think that's probably do not take revenge from Romans. Really helpful. If I had more time, I'd have kept reading. So Romans 12 says, do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it's written, it's mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. So actually, when you're angry, the command to you is to bless your enemies and to feed them. And Jesus tells us to pray for our enemies. And that helpfully reminds me of something that I think I might have missed out of my notes, which is that Jesus's anger was often directed towards the self-righteous and not to those who had a kind of liberal lifestyle. And particularly in light of what's happened in France, I think we need to be really clear that our anger against sin and against people rejecting God should never express itself in kind of violence. Actually, it should express itself in us trying to bless our enemies and leaving God to be the judge. And similarly, when you hear about some of the stuff that happens in America, just not to pick on them, but that's where it happens often, where kind of Christians are there kind of burning Qurans and picketing and kind of shouting at people who go towards abortion clinics and things like that. And kind of being kind of violent if in words or in deeds towards people who aren't living kind of God's way. That doesn't seem to be what the New Testament commands, even though we can be angry about people rejecting God. To express itself in that way isn't New Testament Christianity. Actually, if in any sense there are enemies, we should be blessing them and praying for them rather than shouting at them and trying to harm them. So that's a helpful question there. I'll do a few more and then we'll call it an evening. Let's see. How do I tell if my anger is righteous or not? I find a helpful question to ask myself is, who is being offended, Jesus or me? I think that is a helpful question. Believe in that. I think it's really hard, actually, which is why I didn't give a kind of easy way to know, because certainly my heart, my motives are just often so mixed. So sometimes when it's about me, I think actually there is something objectively wrong here that maybe needs to be spoken out against. Or if, say, Jasper's playing up, I'm angry because he's disobeying me, and that's kind of not God's kind of desire for us as a family. But also, it's a kind of actually this is an inconvenience to me. I feel like so often my motives are mixed. Almost every time I get angry, I need to repent. But it is possible to be righteously angry. I think it's hard just to have a kind of simple question to ask, but I think that is a helpful one to ask. And if it's less to do with you personally, it's less likely that it's just you protecting your own interests. What should we do when we're rightly angry? We'll end with this, about something Jesus would probably be angry about. I think it depends what it is, but certainly prayer is a great thing to do when we're angry. Praying not only for ourselves that our motives would be right, but praying for the person, as Jesus commanded us to do, particularly with our enemies. I think one of the great things about anger, especially when it's good anger, is that it can move us to action. So maybe, let's take that example. Maybe you came to the thing we did on the rights of the unborn. And maybe that both upset you and angered you because you thought actually someone needs to advocate for these people who can't, these babies that can't advocate for themselves. And that might have moved you to write to your MP or to support Breathos or to do something. And that's one of the good things about anger. It can kind of just stir you to actually, I need to be more engaged in this. So sometimes kind of good, right, biblical anger can lead you to good and right biblical action. But again, we should always just be wary and prayerful that it wouldn't consume us, it wouldn't distort into something else, and that the Holy Spirit would use it in the right and good way.